Welcome to everybody at the back. I hope you can all hear us. We'll try and lean forward into our microphone so you're able to hear, because I know you're all really keen to understand everything that's going on in this particular agenda, which is quite busy. I just want to read a webcast notice. This meeting will be webcast and a record retained on the council website for up to 2 years. By participating in this meeting, you are consenting for your name, the content of what you say, and your image to be broadcast and stored to the council website. If any member, officer, or member of the public addressing the committee has concerns with this, please contact committee services officer immediately. For those at home viewing the webcast, I'd like to inform you to look just above the video, you'll see a resources tab. If you select this, a link to the agenda will appear on the right-hand side, and this allows you to open the agenda in PDF form and follow the discussion and debate. Item number two, apologies for absence. I've had apologies from Councillor David Graham and Councillor Joe Bird is deputising. Welcome, Joe. And we also have a new member to the committee. It must be so popular. Thank you, Councillor Lang, for joining us, replacing Councillor Brian Kenny. Item number three is members' declarations of interest. So members are invited to declare any interests in the items on the agenda. Members are asked to consider whether they have any disclosable pecuniary interests and or any other relevant interest in connection with any items on this agenda, and if so, to declare them and state the nature of their interest. No declarations? No, thank you. Item number four, the minutes are in your pack, they're on pages 1 to 4. And so with those members that were here last time we met, and bearing in mind this, we're in mid-October, that's because September's committee meeting was postponed. So this is going back a while to July. If anybody is here and has had a flip through them to check their accuracy, I am happy to prepare them. We have a seconder. Okay. Collins, thank you. And we now have to sign with blood. Any members? Not in line. Okay, that brings us on to item number five, which is public and member questions. I believe we have two people here to ask their question, and if you just would like to come up and is there a microphone set up? Do we have a particular spot? Any, great. So you just come forward to any of the microphones and ask your question by popping the button and the red light up here on the microphone. So do we have Mrs. Miller here? Would you like to come forward and ask your question?
The question that I wish to ask tonight is, can you please confirm the date on which the Bromborough Civic Centre and Library were brought back into full council ownership from the Wirral Growth Company, and whether this information was given to community groups expressing an interest in community asset transfer? If not, why not?
Thank you for attending to ask your question. I have an answer which will then be minuted for you. So the site to which you refer has at all material times been in ownership of Wirral Council. As of the 19th of August 2022, the agreement which gave Wirral Growth Company a conditional option to purchase various sites, which included the site referred to, was amended so that amongst other sites there was no longer any option to purchase in favour of the Wirral Growth Company. This information was not given to the groups expressing an interest in a community asset transfer because the Civic Centre is not in scope for community asset transfer. And as the council has not yet made any decisions about the future use of this building, there was no requirement to do so.
Thank you very much. Just one observation you might like. The Land Registry document referring to that as of last week is still showing that particular interest for Wirral Growth Company regarding the change which was made on the 19th of August. It may have been changed in the last 5 days, but it's currently legally showing that interest when you go onto the land registry. Interesting that you then differentiate between the library and the civic centre, and at the meeting in June, July, we went into that into some detail, and I don't intend to repeat that tonight, though I hope most members will remember. But what is clear is that the library was subject to that conditional option to purchase when the window for expressions of interest was opened. So Romborough Library's position then was completely different to the other libraries designated for closure, because there was clearly no way in which a CAT process could carry on whilst this condition was in place. We were in a different position right from the beginning. And despite correspondence, emails I've had from Mr. McCartan in February saying that the library staying over until November would allow sufficient time for any asset process to take place, and a similar one as a result of minutes of a meeting we had with officers in March, no one at any point brought.
Could you just put the question forward and then officers?
Yeah, just getting there. You need the background. No one at any point told us of this condition attached to the library and civic centre. Therefore, our case still remains, and we would ask, would you agree that given this information, Romborough Library was never treated in an equal way in terms of any expressions of interest for a CAT process? How can you open a CAT process whilst you have the building under this condition?
Thank you. So we do have our sister here, and he would just maybe comment on the land registry point you made.
It does sometimes take some time for land registry to record transactions.
And just in relation to that supplementary, I appreciate all the points you've made. I will bring that in Carton in, but you will get a full written response to the points that you've made tonight directly to you as soon as we've created that response. But it, as a supplementary, it did slightly veer off the question about a date. So I'm happy to bring Ms. McCartan in, but you will get a full written response to this.
Thanks, Chair. Just to say that I will liaise with colleagues involved in the community asset transfer process to provide that full written response.
Thank you. Thank you for your question, please.
I'll just come back in. Thank you for that. I'm not quite sure whether why that information isn't available today.
So the information will be available to you as soon as we can collate it, but the idea of a supplementary question is it has to relate to my response to your original question, and your original question was about a date.
Yeah. Okay.
So in terms of especially in terms of the legal details you'd like to go into, it's only fair that officers are given plenty of time to be able to collate a response to you, and it probably will be. I would imagine the officers will be David Ball and Sam Carrier involved, and they're just not here at the moment. But you'll get a written response.
Thank you very much. In that case, thank you for listening to me tonight. My organisation, the Friends of Romborough Library, have tried to work through democratic processes for the whole of this sorry story. And we remain convinced that Romborough was never on an equal playing field with the other libraries, and it's the responsibilities of the Council under the Libraries Act so to do has not been met. Romborough feels betrayed and will not forget. Thank you for your time.
Of Friends of Romborough Library, same as Mel and Wadeka, everything that was just related. I think in part the question that you have in front of you has in a way been answered in recent correspondence. Not all of it, but certainly part of it. But it's come very late in the day in answering these questions, I have to to say. Well, the question is, in the interests of equity and other libraries, and as a friend of the Bromborough Library, we are seeking assurances that all items belonging to the Friends, such as settees, children's tables, etc., remain in the library until the future of the library, as far as the cap process is clarified. We are additionally asking for the book stock owned by Library Services to remain mothballed in the library also until the cap process is clarified.
Thank you for your question. Thank you for attending to ask it. I do have a response here to be limited. As part of a consistent and equitable approach across those library sites set to close and currently being considered as part of the community asset transfer process, the council will be emptying those existing buildings of all contents. Any books, larger items of furniture, or any other items that have been identified as belonging to the Friends of Bromborough Library or Friends Groups of any other libraries, and which have not already been removed by the Friends Groups, will be safely stored pending any future decisions to be taken on transfer. The Library Service has had a number of conversations with the Friends of Bromborough Library on this matter.
The book stock owned by the Library Services, is that not part of the same thing?
Okay, so the library, the decision taken that the library would close, so any books, larger items of furniture, any of the items that are identified as belonging to the Friends of Bromborough Library or Friends Groups of any of the libraries which have not already been removed, will be safely stored pending future decisions to be taken on transfer. But that would be anything that's identified that is part of your Friends Groups.
Yeah, so that excludes the book stock owned by the Council Library Services.
Okay, what I can do is refer you back to minutes from a previous meeting when the decision was made, and we'll provide an answer to you in full to that, because that was all explicit as part of the budget decision.
Okay. Well, I have to say, it's very late in the day to make a decision on this, and we're sort of at the last minute trying to move things around, recognising that the end date is coming.
Yes, the team will be doing this for a lot of sites as well, so they will keep you busy. But thank you, and I do appreciate it. It's very frustrating for you. I'll be making a statement. Okay, I just wanted to confirm. There was a question submitted in relation to Bromborough Library and Civic Centre by another member of the public, but it was ruled out. And the rules around that is it was materially the same as a question put in the last 6 months. It's particularly the same as a question, and I didn't hear this question, unfortunately, I was stuck on the M6, but the question was put to the Council on the 10th of December, and the Council resolved to refer the matter to this committee. Therefore, it will be added to the work programme for the Chair and supposed to consider, and I will propose that a further report is considered at a future meeting following policy and resources consideration of the asset strategy. I just wanted to clarify that, so that will be minuted as well, because it is upsetting when you want to ask a public question when you're able to, but there are certain rules around it, as there are around supplementaries. So just to move on to statements and petitions, I don't think any are received, but I wanted to make a statement particularly with Bromborough Library in mind, because it's been frustrating for me not to be able to say anything. You'll notice if you download the pack, if you have a public pack or you have an agenda pack with you, you'll notice in item 9 in the agenda point 3.9, it describes how the new library model has co-location of council services and the underlying principle. And one example given is Seacombe Library moving to the Children's Centre in February 2022 to be an integral part of the community hub. And you'll also see in point 4.4, it references identifying and successfully delivering co-located sites in the right complementary locations will have multiple benefits, amongst which are reducing the financial burden related to the asset estate, reducing energy consumption and carbon emissions, and maximisation of staff resources and increased footfall. So I fully endorse the multiple benefits of co-location for council services. In fact, the principle of a close proximity of a number of key elements is what I would describe as a village. And I really want to see village life preserved across all areas of the world. And speaking as a ward councillor, many of the residents who live near to Marfords Park or in Raybier or Brookhurst, as well as Broughton Lanslin, all frequent Bromborough Village and they would all like to see it thriving. So I understand the irony of a library already co-located within a civic centre and not progressing in this recent community asset transfer process. I get that that's frustrating. One of the first questions I had at PNR in February from a member of the public on this issue described how the community had overturned a decision around this asset and the World Growth Company in 2005. Well, you've just heard my previous answer. On August the 19th, this year, 19th August 2022, the agreement which gave the Wirral Growth Company the additional option to purchase various sites was amended so that there was no longer any option to purchase in favour of the Wirral Growth Company. So it feels like a long protracted thing, but it's the 19th of August that it actually happened, and I am just able to respond to that now because it was all exempt. So I appreciate the efforts of all of our officers in trying to keep all the interested parties informed. I believe David Ball and Sandra Cameron have spoken to groups endlessly and groups from three political parties endlessly asking questions about this. So I appreciate all their efforts to keep informed and I really hope that we can get to a pragmatic and practical solution soon for Bromborough Library. Thank you.
First section covers the revenue budget monitoring position, which is reported here to our Chair. My question is initially about clarification and trying to expand on that a bit. So my understanding is that the settled budget for public health is around 30 million annually, of which 6.359 is the budget that's being quoted here. I just want to know for clarification whether that had increased or reduced in amount. I'm just concerned that given the amount of preventative medicine that we're doing in the community, and given that the incidence of heart disease, cancer and other chronic diseases is increasing, should we not be investing more in preventative medicine rather than reducing the amount of spend? Thank you.
Overall, that's the 6.359
million
that we're using to the neighbourhoods early into this community, so it's reduced the parts of related to the leisure services and other areas of the tourism committee. But within any roles, other areas within the council that's contributing to other areas of public health that are included in this committee, so it's just a smaller amount.
will see when the quarter two report is finalised, that is an improving picture in some savings. In terms of also monitoring as officers, we've got a programme management approach to that as a senior team. And you know, it's daily on our minds, and we are looking at those savings and how we're achieving them. But I take your point on board on management, these are quite out of date now. Quarter one, quite a transition period from the year end, which finished positively, to that first. There's a lot of change and a lot of infrastructure and resources required to deliver on the in-year savings, but we will see on the savings and the infrastructure when we see quarter two.
Thank you. So quarter two will be reported to the next committee.
Yes, and to be fair, this was prepared in advance of the September committee, wasn't it? So it always feels a bit too late to be able to impact our point, doesn't it, then, class-wise?
Thank you. I have two questions, but one's already been answered. But there's not a question, but it's a comment. It's great to see that actually the council put in a large number of defibs around the borough, especially at football pitches. I'm sure all members will probably agree with the condemnation of those who have decided to destroy those life-saving defibs. I was going to use a very strong word, but I've been advised not to, but the place where I'm going to put it is the vandals need to be aware that they are going there to save lives, and it's great to see the council have to put them, and they are going to put about 49 around the borough, and I think it's great to see, and they're encouraging a lot of football teams to actually purchase their own as well. But I condemn, I'm sure all colleagues will agree with it, that we condemn those who have destroyed the ones in a number of places. So that's what the comments I'd like to make. Thank you.
Thanks, Councillor Smith.
Okay, thanks, Chair. So just wanted to ask you on the culture and visitor economy budget, £265,000 we spent. Seems really low to me. We consider what's coming into Merseyside in the next year or two. You know, we've got the Sporting Golf out of Eurovision, Liverpool, Wirral of Culture. I mean, isn't it a great opportunity to showcase the authority and get, you know, the visitor economy increasing? I know that there was a fall during the pandemic and that. So, you know, it's really great. And helpfully, on item 6, Culture and Heritage Strategy and Borough Culture Planning, Jane Morgan, Senior Officer, outlines all the excellent things that are happening. So, personally, I would think we'll be struggling with a budget like that if you're going to try and encourage, you know, sort of not thousands of people, but millions of people possibly making their way across here, either from Liverpool or because of the open golf and that. So, is that.
Thanks for that. That's not really a technical budget, was set by us, so that's not really a technical question for Sarah, but definitely Jane's been working so hard with the Visitor Economy Board and with our plan for the future, and it's the next item, so you have to come up and sit with us anyway, Jane. So are you happy to take that question?
Thanks, Councillor Smith. Yeah, in terms of, you're right in terms of the opportunities that are presenting themselves to us over the next 2 years. So we've got the Open, we've got the Eurovision next year, notably, and then we're Borough of Culture again in 2024. I think what's not in any great detail, possibly in the report that I've brought to committee this evening, again, this was prepared in September, so like in some ways some things have moved on. But in terms of our funding strategy, we always recognise that there would be less of a core revenue budget for this work, particularly for Borough of Culture, and that we needed to kind of work in a different way and look at grant funding from the likes of the Arts Council, National Lottery Heritage Fund, but also other opportunities coming through. So the detail is still being worked through, but the UK Shared Prosperity Fund, which is being coming through the Combined Authority, will also have opportunities for culture, heritage and visitor economy. So it's aligning those opportunities with our core revenue budget. I would say in terms of sort of experience around last time, it was around having a really good cohesive team and partnership to deliver these opportunities. And I would say we are really building that up again, that's both city region and colleagues. They're working obviously particularly with Eurovision, etc., but also at the local level, making sure that all of our partners are really, really involved in planning and bringing their resources to bear when we come to deliver a programme. Mike, is it another subject?
No, it's part of it's a question.
Okay, no problem.
I believe that we've received or going to be receiving money from the LTA in regards to this new tennis centre. So we've got here an improvement facility upgrade of £765,000. Wasn't that the money we had with the LTA to pay for the improvement besides the outside?
Yeah, you're referring to capital in the table, aren't you?
Yeah.
You want to just be specific.
Sorry, yeah, it's table, appendix 3, capital.
Thanks.
Thanks, Chair. Thanks, Councillor Collins. So, there are a number of things taking place at the Wirral Tennis and Sports Centre, one of which is the LTA occupancy of part of the site, which is where we'll be getting the money from the LTA. The other is the remodelling of the other half of the site, which is where we'll be introducing the soft play and the new gym and other sort of new developments. So that 765 will relate to that bit, not the LTA.
That's fine,
thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Jenny, Professor
Johnson.
Thank you. Thank you, Chair. I'm just wondering whether we're now through COVID restrictions on site, because if not, then that's obviously going to have an impact on income. Talk about cost savings here, also trying to bring in resources. And so, is there anything still existing relating to COVID restrictions? And if so, why? Thank you.
Thank you, Chair. Thanks, Councillor Johnson. In terms of certainly leisure and library sites, which I've been going to speak about, the only existing COVID restrictions are in some of the library sites where we've got small rooms where occupancy numbers are limited and ventilation is poor, and those assessments have been made with colleagues in assets based on health and safety guidance, and we are in the process of installing CO2 monitors in a lot of those sites to help with that, but it is a limited number.
Just in relation to that then, can it outside individuals choose to use those different parts of those sites and take the risk themselves in relation to health and safety, or are you regarding on national? So where are the health and safety guidelines coming from, I guess, in relation to that? Thank you.
Thank you,
David
Armstrong.
Just a reply to that, the government have reminded us, and HSE have reminded us that we still have all the duties from the 74 Act as an employer, so we have to, that also extends to non-employees, so we do have a duty. We try and hard to lift these restrictions as soon as we can, because Andy outlined there are a small number of spaces where, because the ventilation needs to be improved, but we cannot actually allow more people in the numbers currently permitted. Otherwise, if something did happen, particularly some of those user groups are older groups who are more susceptible to serious illness from COVID, we do want to be careful about that, and as I say, we still have the duty for the employer to our employees and to the non-employees. But it is tapering off. We are currently dealing with those issues item by item.
Thank you, David, and we do have an item on the agenda around libraries, so we could possibly explore it more. Was that on the same point of order today, or another point? On the same one? Okay, thanks. Councillor Bird.
Thank you. So, Brighton Civic Centre includes a very large hall, over 100 people capacity, and groups have not been able to book it because of the ventilation, health and safety issues, so we're told, but it's another reason why Romber community feels betrayed, because we see other facilities being open for more than 5 or 8 people, and it's a source of income for the council that is being turned away. I was actually quite shocked about a month ago. I received an email telling us that Romber Civic Centre had been closed for bookings when I don't remember that decision coming to any democratic decision making.
Thanks. So more of a comment, not for Sarah, but David's happy to come back in, because we probably could deal with this in a section that we're dealing with.
I can appreciate the frustrations, Chair, but I can assure you that the Bromley Civic Centre was assessed on the same basis as all the other buildings that were assessed for capacity. It's a building I've been to sometimes for carol concerts and things. It is a difficult building to ventilate by the way it's laid out and by the window pattern that it has in the bigger hall. So it hasn't been treated any differently. It was assessed the same, and in fact, Jeanette's team have obtained quotes to improve the ventilation should that be necessary, depending on the decision you make about the building.
Thank you. So just to move then to the recommendations. We're still on item 10, but we're still at the start. So the recommendations here are for the Tourism Community Sculpture and Leisure Committee to note the forecast revenue position presented at quarter one, note the progress on delivery of the 22-23 savings programme at quarter one, note the forecast level of reserves at quarter one, and note the forecast capital position presented at quarter one. And I would need to propose those recommendations. Do I have a seconder? Councillor Smith, thank you for seconding. Do we all agree those on consent and look forward to a more up-to-date picture on quarter two? Thank you. Okay, we can go back now to the running order, because Jane has joined us anyway, and thank you, Keith, for being joined as well. So item number six, in your pack, that we have to go right back to the top again, it's pages 5 to 26. This is the Culture and Heritage Strategy of Borough of Culture. I'm going to invite Jane Morgan to present the report, and then we'll have questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Chair, and thanks to members of the committee for receiving this report this evening. This report pertains to the Culture and Heritage Strategy for Birkenhead, which was approved by this committee on the 8th of March this year, and incorporates an update on the Museum Service Strategy, which was approved alongside the Culture and Heritage Strategy, in recognition of the joint working between Regeneration Strategy, the team that I'm in, and leading on culture, heritage and visitor economy, and working across with neighbourhood colleagues who obviously manage our significant cultural assets in the borough. So the report does also sets out the proposed approach for planning for Borough of Culture in 2024. Members of the committee will hopefully recall the programme we delivered in 2019, which was extremely successful. It was pre-COVID, but we have lots of learning from that, which we can feed into the next iteration. And again, very different landscape, but we're hoping that the planning we're proposing will bring to bear a really, really good programme for that year. I will just move on to the main body of the report, if that's okay. We, in particular in respect of Borough Culture, it is important to say that this is a local city region initiative, which was established through the Mayoral Percent for Culture and the Liverpool City Region Cultural Strategy. So it's on a rotation amongst boroughs of the Liverpool City Region, and we've all participated as boroughs in that. So I think there is obviously an option for us not to deliver that, but that would have obviously reputation issues as well as being not maximising the potential opportunities of it, or we could deliver a minimal programme with existing resources. As it stands, we know we can do some fantastic things working with our communities if we plan ahead, but actually if we start to build that resource package as per Councillor Smith's question for, then we can deliver so much more in that year. So I just wanted to, in the main body of the report, highlight some of the progress that's been made since March in terms of the cultural and heritage strategy and the museum strategy. There is a more detailed appendix which sets out a progress against the actions in the action plan that again was